I'm very happy to be here today, and the topic of my subject is pharmacists working in international development. The following outline will be followed. First, I will speak about my career as a pharmacist. Then, the status of pharmacy in developing countries, so that to give it context. And then pharmacists in international NGOs. I will be using examples from Ethiopia. And then finally, a recommendation. If I could tell you a little bit about myself, I have been working as a pharmacist since 1978. First in procurement and distribution with the government agency, and then I did postgraduate studies. I did a PhD in pharmacology, came back and worked as a technical expert for the drug selection committee of that agency. And then in 1990, I joined the Addis Ababa University School of Pharmacy, where I had worked as chairman of the Department of Pharmacology, as well as the Dean of the School of Pharmacy for the last 4 years. I have worked in many government agencies, committees, boards, including I've been on the board of the Ethiopian Drug Administration and Control Authority. I have worked as the chairman of the Ethiopian Standards Committee on Pharmaceuticals, where we were trying to blend different monographs from USP, the British Pharmacopoeia, International Pharmacopoeia, you know, choosing appropriate ones, which you thought appropriate were for our purpose. And then I have worked as chairman of the Technical Advisory Committee for the Ethiopian Health and Nutrition Research Institute. I was a lead consultant who designed the first Ethiopian standard treatment guidelines, and so on. Let's talk about the status of pharmacy in a developing country like Ethiopia. As you well know, most developing countries are resource constrained. They have very many competing priorities, not only in the health area, but also in education, in agriculture. Food security is a big problem. And they're extremely vulnerable to external factors like climate change. We know the El Nino effect resulting in food insecurity in many African countries, for example. They're prone to outbreaks of epidemics like Ebola. So they also suffer from a lack of systems. There is no adequate infrastructure. Governance is a big issue, and the workforce is not highly motivated for reasons you might guess. And there are many barriers, socioeconomic barriers to access to medicines, like geographic barrier, economic barrier, cultural barrier to medicine. So when we look at pharmacy services in developing countries, we need to look at it in this context. From this perspective, this is extremely important because when we talk about interventions, transplanting a well-developed system from a developed country to a resource-constrained setting like the one I just explained will not be effective. NGOs, donors. Have a very prominent role in the development of pharmacy services in developing countries. The response to HIV/AIDS and Ebola are examples. And due to the reasons I just mentioned, developing countries on their own are not in a position, due to these competing priorities, to improve, expand the pharmaceutical service on their own. So here come global development workers, international NGOs, and donors and funders. The areas attracting most funding are listed here. They include HIV, AIDS, TB, malaria, maternal and child health, family planning and reproductive health. Of course, the pharmaceutical supply chain attracts a lot of money. Leadership and governance, which is quite cross-cutting. Pharmacy service and system strengthening, human resource for health and healthcare financing. Those I highlighted in red have a direct pharmaceutical component, commodities, but others are also equally important. Maternal and child health, for example, is extremely important, and the pharmacist here can do much valuable contribution by making sure that essential commodities for maternal and child health are available, for example. Human resource development, human resource for health, the pharmacist is a major team player of this health force, so it's also extremely important. What are the rewards of working with international NGOs as a pharmacist? I would be talking about certain USAID implemented projects, but behind these projects, please remember there are pharmacists. So I would be talking about pharmacists, essentially. International NGOs are results oriented. The donor uses taxpayer money, so it's a must that the implementer shows results. Otherwise, after 1 year, the money will not be there. So this is a motivating factor. And as a result, one is able to see the impact of one's work, which is highly rewarding. International NGOs have a very empowering environment for their staff due to the resources I just mentioned, due to the expertise, the pool of experts they have, the tools, and this is really, it makes them a great place to work, as they say. They are less bureaucratic, especially when you compare them with government agencies. And there is plenty of opportunity for professional growth because one is expected to be innovative. There is a wide platform for collaboration with global experts and opinion leaders. Now, lest you think that it's all a bed of roses, there are also extreme challenges working for international development. The most important one is that the project you implement should have a buy-in by the host government, that it should address the priority needs of that government. I have seen many a project, well-intended, well-funded, with experts implementing it, that has flopped because it didn't address the priority concern of the host government. Host government bureaucracy, you may say differences in culture, in the way of doing things between a developing country and essentially an imported style of doing business by international NGOs, sometimes results in conflicts. And the bureaucracy of the host government could be a red limiting factor in project implementation. But the most important challenge really is sustainability and ownership. I have tried to illustrate this with this picture I got on a website. The biggest challenge is really, if you have to take this elephant from point A to point B, there are two ways of doing that. One is like this guy is doing, which is difficult but doable. But certainly the elephant will not do it on its own. The preferred route would be to teach the elephant to cross this tightrope and get from A to B. If a project has been well implemented by doing the job for the host government, for the host agency, and then when the project ends, that job cannot be done, then we should say that project has failed. I give some illustrations of NGO work, international NGO work, with examples from Ethiopia. The first one is the response to the HIV/AIDS epidemic when free ART was started in Ethiopia in 2005. MSH, my company for which I work now, Management Sciences for Health, was called to do the quantification, procurement, storage, distribution of these commodities. So pharmacists were in great demand to do this job. We also had took this as an opportunity to improve pharmacy services. You know, we introduced electronic tools of for dispensing, for inventory management, for information management generally, and provided training to many health professionals, including doctors, on the kinetics of these drugs, on adverse reactions, on conflicts in selecting drug regimens. So that's a very challenging one. And then there were challenges for which we were able to find simple solutions. You know, stigma and discrimination is a big factor. It still is in many countries, including Ethiopia. And in the picture on the left, you can see medicines being dispensed in a very crowded setting. You can imagine what kind of confidentiality one could talk about here. And unless you convey the message, you know, while dispensing about the right way of taking the medicines, the patient would forget because his attention or her attention was somewhere else. So we came up with this simple idea of building dispensing booths attached to each window. And there was privacy and adherence really improved by some measurements. You know, some of the customers were very curious, too curious, I should say, that they would be peeping through the window what the other guy was getting. So we had to paint them white in some hospitals. Yeah. And then using this vertical fund for HIV/AIDS, we were able to renovate more than 200 pharmacies to have a proper dispensing counseling rooms for information management for the computers. And you can see the one before and after renovation. And really, by improving the working area, you can imagine how pharmacists feel now working in such improved setting. But stigma is still a very serious problem, and pharmacists had to do a lot of work in combating stigma. What you see here is patients, you know, after even proper counseling by a pharmacist during dispensing, leaving the outer package in the pharmacy because they don't want to take this bulky medication home so that, you know, they're afraid their relatives, even spouses, could see that. You know, some even hide the fact that they are on treatment from their spouses. So we designed interventions that to improve adherence and combat stigma, and improvement was observed in this. So that's one area where a pharmacist can positively contribute. Strengthening the regulatory affairs of the country, the Drug Administration and Control Authority of Ethiopia was a major undertaking, where we set up five branches provided them with technical staff, you know, with seconded staff, donated 5 land cruisers to do inspection across the porous border areas because there was a lot of contraband, illicit drug movement. And for 2 years, we intensively supported with training, external visits, and with computers and all the hardware and software. After 2 years, the government agency was overtook these 5 branches, and they are now up and running without any external. This is an intervention which was successful in its sustainability, and we're very proud of that. Human resource development was another area where we contributed. So to this agency, a lot of support was made in medicines quality control, drug quality assurance, USP's PQM program, for example, has helped the agency to get ISO certification for many of the methods of analysis. Now pending WHO accreditation, the quality control lab has been strengthened with reference standards. People have been trained, and you can see how an international NGO donor funding can really upgrade the quality of service. We have automated product registrations. There was a huge backlog of product registration. It was not open and transparent. Now one goes online and can get this done in a few weeks compared to years in the past. Governance is another issue, a very cross-cutting one, but there are still issues, but some significant work has also been done there. Another important area worth mentioning is the start of patient-oriented pharmacy services. We made an assessment and found, we have long known that, but we made a formal assessment and knew that, found that poor dispensing and counseling was common practice all over Ethiopian pharmacies. The outcome from medication was not known. And the main task of the pharmacist was the classical role of the pharmacist, that of procurement, storage, dispensing, okay? Counter-centered, should I say. The topic of this speech is careers beyond the pharmacy counter. What's really touching here is in one of the meetings with the Regional Health Bureau, an official of the Health Bureau said, I can hire 2 pharmacy technicians for the price of 1 pharmacist. Many of my colleagues were there, I was there at this meeting. And this was really the point, the statement that triggered action that steered the pharmaceutical association implementers in the area of pharmacy. One couldn't blame this official because he didn't see any difference between a pharmacy technician and a pharmacist. They both procure drugs, medicines, store, dispense, do paperwork. There was no patient-oriented service that could have differentiated, that could have utilized the intensive training the pharmacists got during these 5-6 years of higher learning. So, because as I said, the training in the schools was product-oriented, the service was also product-oriented. So we sat together with colleagues in our project, with the association, with other government agencies, and said these things should change. First, we conducted consultative meetings with hospital CEOs and medical directors. We had to create the demand, if you wish, sensitize these officials that there's really much beyond what they know about pharmacy services in a hospital setting. Then we designed in-service training for practicing pharmacists, a one-man's intensive training. And then we embarked on, with the schools of pharmacy, on revising the curriculum for a lasting effect. These are pictures during the sensitization meeting. And five one-month long trainings were conducted. And some 200 pharmacists were trained on the job. You didn't call these people clinical pharmacists, but they really got a nice orientation in the advantages of clinical pharmacy. And then we helped revise the job description and designed also an MND tool to see the difference, you know, what's the value add for this investment. These are pictures during the ward rounds and chart review sessions. This innovative approach was shared with the global community. We published our work in the American Journal of Pharmaceutical Education in 2011. So what was the outcome? In 1,708 cases, these pharmacists found unnecessary drug prescribing. In 2,405, there was a need for additional medication. In 771 cases, the drug prescribed was totally ineffective. In 868, the dosage was too low. In 751, the dosage was too high. There were 361 adverse drug reactions and non-compliance, I should say, non-adherence was close to 1,400, you know, just in a couple of years. And the interventions that corrected these abnormalities, should I say, were equally impressive. So, once the hospital CEOs and medical directors were able to witness this, they bought the idea. Now they are sending their pharmacists for postgraduate studies in clinical pharmacy in the country and abroad. And I should say clinical pharmacy, I wouldn't yet say pharmaceutical care, is in a very strong, has a very strong footing now. Another intervention was with the rural drug vendors. You know, Ethiopia is an extremely rural country. More than 80% of the population lives in rural areas, and rural drug vendors who are licensed to dispense a certain number of medicines, including some antibiotics, are the primary accessible source for medication and sometimes treatment to the rural population. But these people were totally neglected. Nobody remembered about them. And the Drug Administration Control Authority, what it did was really to control them rather than guide them and improve their standards and help them. So we designed a curriculum and started training these people in one of the biggest regions. These were the findings during the assessment. As you could imagine, you know, there was no counseling. The premises were inadequate. They kept both expired and good drugs together. And all the rest. So after these extensive trainings, and mentoring and a provision of materials, resources like drug lists, which were already there, and dispensing manuals, we were able to witness that a 76% increase in counseling time during dispensing by these rural drug vendors. 33 to 57% increase in their understanding of first-line anti-malaria drugs. And there was a decrease from 24 to 11% in injection practices. You know, simple interventions carried out by pharmacists having wide effects, wide implications. Another area is antimicrobial resistance, which is a big topic globally, as you know. And actually, MSH established the first national antimalarial, resistance advisory group in the country. A strategic plan was designed, and media personnel were trained, as well as professionals were trained. This also had significant effects, widespread publication and radio broadcast on, to sensitize the population about the perils of improper antimicrobial use. So, what's the recommendation I have? I will read it. If you want to improve the health of people in developing countries, and if you believe in putting yourself out of a job, you might say, I don't like this, but not out of your profession. That is, the results of your contribution will be sustainable when your projects end. You should join pharmacists working in international development. I had raised this as a challenge initially. Sustainability and ownership of what you do is extremely important. You could finish a project, work yourself out of a job, but you will be invited to do more challenging jobs as a pharmacist. Thank you.